They told me Turkey's coastline has been spoilt. All high-rise hotels, hamburger joints, and hordes of people packing the beaches. Well, maybe some of it has, but with 5,000 miles of coast to choose from, you can avoid the crowded resorts and find treasures like Olu Deniz. It is beautiful, but don't believe everything you read about it.
Some of the brochures describe this beach as a long stretch of coarse silver sand. Well, there is some right up at the top, but how coarse does it have to get before they call this pebbles?
No sandcastles on this beach, but no grit in your sandwiches either. This is the view from my room in the Pension Manzara. It's a bit of a walk to the beach, 20 minutes down the hill. And up? I'm afraid I took the bus, with a regular service for about 10 pence. Who wouldn't?
Manzara. That's my first Turkish word, and it means panorama. All of the rooms are like this one here. Except that some of them have got what they call a French bed. That's a double to you or me.
We hear a lot about Turkish baths. Here, I'm OK. Elsewhere, I'm not so sure. Somewhere under the face pack is Susie.
OK, here we are in the mud bath now. What you have to do is, this is all full of fantastic healing properties, and you have to rub it on all over, much more like this. None of you have got to chicken out, by the way. You rub it all on and then it'll go dry in about 5-10 minutes in the sun. And after it's gone dry, you walk down to the river and you wash it off. And then we'll sit in the sulphur spring and warm up again.
It's a sort of rural beautician's, but I don't think the laundrette will agree.
You reckon you'd like my job? This is the second year running I've had to cover myself in smelly mud, and this stuff's got frogs in!
The frogs seem happy to share their mud bath with us, but if they spend their whole lives in it, why aren't they prettier? Anyway, wash and soak cycle completed. Now for the rinse. Quite apart from the mudlark, this Dalyan Delta itself marks an important part in the sensible development of tourism in Turkey. A proposed hotel complex would have wiped out the breeding grounds of the loggerhead turtle, but thankfully along came the conservationists.
Unfortunately, we won the case and they stopped building it, and they've made this into a total conservation area. There's brilliant lots of birds, bee-eaters, ospreys, all sorts of kinds of birds here.
But there's more than wildlife. There are signs of ancient life here. Scattered all along this coastline are the remains of life from as long as 3,000 years ago. Overlooking the water are the ruins of the city of Kaunos.
OK, the amphitheatre that we're in at the moment is dated back from the 6th century when the Carians were here. The Carians first built in the 6th century, and then the Greeks came along, and the Greeks sort of invaded, but they fairly well lived together, and the Greeks knocked the whole lot down and started all over again.
There are lots of gaps in our knowledge of the times before the Greeks arrived, not least because the people here had their own alphabet, which still hasn't been deciphered.
What we do know about this port is that it traded in fish, salt and slaves, but much more than that is going to have to wait until we crack their language.
Somehow they managed to carve these tombs high in the cliffs, too high to climb up to. But in nearby Fethiye, you can get a closer look at some rock tombs from the 4th century BC. But not all Turkish ruins are old. In the hills behind Fethiye lies the ghost town of Kaya. 70 years ago, it was a thriving community. But when Turkey became a republic, the Greeks who lived in it were moved out. Now only a handful of farmers live in the valley. A beautifully simple life, but traditional simplicity doesn't always come cheaply.
Oh, it's nice, but it's not traditional at all, is it, all those flowers?
Oh, we have also traditional carpets, such as this one, as you can see, a praying one, and you direct this to Mecca if you want to pray at home.
Yes.
And as you can see, there is a holy lamp in the middle. This is the running water symbol. It means the symbol of fertility.
So how much is a carpet like this then?
£450.
Oh, it's quite expensive, isn't it? Do you have anything smaller? Well, these, yes. How much?
Yes.
How expensive are these?
There is a fine tashpınar from Central Anatolia. This is all vegetable dyes too, like that one.
Yes, it's lovely, isn't it? And how much is this?
This is only £50.
£50. Yes, I do like that. I think I'll have it.
A dent in my budget. I hope I still like it when I get it home. but the budget is standing up quite well elsewhere, particularly in the restaurants. Tonight we've got aubergines, or aubergines, or aubergines. Yes, the great Turkish cookbook, 40 Things to Do with Aubergines. But honestly, the food is much more varied than, say, in Greece. And for anything between £2 and £7, you can get a really good meal.
Are you sure? What are you having?
Two cheesecakes, and what we call steak. I've forgotten what you call it.
The fish is good, but check the price before you order. It can be very expensive, because the winter fishermen spend the summer where the money is, taking tourists on goulette boat trips.
Father Christmas was born in Patara, and he worked in the sea, but he was very keen on children. He gave all the presents, which is where the Father Christmas bit came into it.
My mum told me Father Christmas lives at the North Pole, but Susie's talking about the original Santa Claus, St Nicholas. We're heading for a little island named after him. The church here has heard the prayers of three people's religions, Greeks, Romans and Christians. Now, the only voices are holidaymakers and their tour guides.
As you walk through, you can see some steps, a piece of rock going the length of the thing, which was probably a seat. As you can see behind me, there is the remains of the apse. That's probably the most beautiful part of the church that's actually left. They reckon that the whole of the church was probably covered with this white marble stone. You can see remains of it all fallen down, all in the rubble beneath.
There are lots of stories explaining why the roof to this once covered walkway was built. My favourite is about the princess who loved swimming in the sea.
She had the passage built to protect her from the sun as she walked down to the water's edge because she didn't want a suntan. In those days it was fashionable to be pale and interesting. Don't times change?
We filmed in May and it was quite hot enough for me. Midsummer practically guarantees 100 degrees Fahrenheit and more. But there's much more to Turkey than just another sunny bit of the Mediterranean, much more than just another beach destination. It's a unique bridge between Europe and Asia, its vast coastline largely unspoilt but not untouched by tourism. Where the mass invasion has started, there are already alarming similarities to the pillaging of the Costas. It's hard for the Turks to say no to the instant wealth of tourism. But hopefully there are those who know that the beauty and the beast can live together. My first trip left a lasting impression. Even now, a few days after Christmas, this is the one Turkey I wouldn't mind seeing forever.